And now we are jumping in the next keynote lecture, which is Power to Patient-Centered Approach in Cancer Care, and will be presented by Antonella Cardone, who is a director of European Cancer Patient Coalition. The word is yours. Would you like us to assist with the slides, or you prefer to control them by yourself?
Thank you, Georgiana. If you can share the slides, that will be very helpful.
They are coming in a few seconds. Thank you.
So, well, good morning or afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the Biotech Atelier for inviting me here today to talk about such an important topic, as it is a patient-centered approach when it comes to cancer care. So while waiting for the slides to come up, well, as Georgiana said, I'm Antonella Cardone. I'm the director at the European Cancer Patient Coalition, ECPC. And during today's presentation, I will try to give a brief overview on the importance of patient involvement in cancer care and their key role. So firstly, I will give some details on what ECPC is and what we have been doing, the main activities and initiatives that we have been working on recently to foster and strengthen a patient-centered approach in cancer care. So next slide, please. So just to provide a quick outline of what I will be talking about for the next 20 minutes or so, ECPC has been a partner in the PREFER project, focusing on strengthening patient-centric decision-making processes. So during my talk, I will also highlight the relevance that this patient-centered approach has in survivorship research programs, as well as the need for multidisciplinary and professional patient-centered institutions. To preserve the rights of cancer patients' survivors. And towards the end of my presentation, I will focus on the importance of the implementation of public policies so that cancer survivors' working lives, employability, are safeguarded. And I will then highlight the need for psychological support and palliative care. Moreover, I will also give some insights on personalized medicine for cancer patients and the health technology assessment regulation aimed at reducing the burdensome administrative process of clinical assessments by focusing on collaboration between member states. So before starting my intervention, I would like to highlight that cancer patients are directly affected by the decision on the availability of new medicines, their affordability, and the effects that these treatments have on their daily life. At the same time, they have a unique knowledge and perspectives, being the ultimate beneficiaries of medical technologies. And not only that, let me clarify something else, which I consider to be very essential. Patient preferences, experiences, and stories are an inestimable resource, and they ought to be considered in the agenda setting, formulation, and implementation of policies regarding the assessment of health technologies carried out by public bodies. So now I will give you some a quick highlight on what ECPC does, so to help setting the scene. So ECPC is the largest cancer patients umbrella organization in Europe, and it was established in 2003. We advocate for patients to be acknowledged as equal partners and co-creator of their own health. And last but not least, at the European Cancer Patient Coalition, we work for a Europe of equality, where all cancer patients have timely and affordable access to the best treatment and care available throughout their life, no matter where they were born or live. Next slide. So regarding our mission, I would like to mention here that our main aim is to empower patients through the communication and dissemination of information, as well as foster cooperation among our members. As I always say, patients are the best advocates for themselves, but to do so, they need to be empowered through capacity building, raising awareness, and education activities. Health literacy, of course, is key. Next slide. One of our main aims is to make cancer a priority so that it has a top position in the European health policy agenda, and that cancer patients, not only, no matter where they live in Europe, have access to their treatment and their needs are satisfied. Therefore, we focus on cancer research, and we also have an active role in shaping healthcare policies at both European and national level. Next slide. Well, very briefly, I would like to mention that we represent at EU level more than 450 members from 50 different countries, EU member states and non-EU member states. We have at least one member in each continent. Next slide. Next slide. Okay. ECPC has been a partner in the PREFER project, which aims to provide an evidence-based account of how and when patient preference studies should be performed to support and inform medical decision-making. The PREFER patient preferences in benefit risk assessment during the drug life cycle project is an IMI innovative medicine initiative project funded 50% by public money and 50 the European Commission and 50% by private funds, the pharmaceutical industry, with 6 million euros, and it started in 2016 and will end in May 2022. And it will last overall almost 6 years. The increased focus on patient preferences stands within the global aim of strengthening patient-centric decision-making throughout the life cycle of medicinal products, including medical devices. So PREFER has established the recommendations to support the development of guidelines for industry, regulatory authorities and the HTA bodies on how and when to include patient perspectives on benefits and risks of medicinal products. A series of patient preference studies have been run in both academic and industry settings. The main aim of this is to provide a better understanding of the recommended best practice approach to patient preference studies. The project also shows how patient preference studies can give valuable information to support decision-making for regulators and HTA bodies. Giving patients a voice in the development of treatments means we first need to listen to them. Together with the universities and companies, they are part of developing recommendations for when and how patient preferences can be part of decision-making on whether or not to develop a treatment, if it should be approved, become available to patients, and what to do in case there are safety concerns after it is put on the market. So this means that we are involved in the research and have a voice in PREFER's decision-making bodies. To complement this, we involve patients and patient organizations in clinical patient preference case studies. So PREFER patient partners take on a proactive role in the project to make sure that what it is done for patients is also designed, first of all, and understood by patients. This way, there is a major role for patients and patient advocates in the review process. Next slide. Therefore, there is a need to promote an interdisciplinary patient-centered approach for specific survivorship research programs and to develop and elaborate new tools. In order to facilitate survivorship research, including the assessment of the well-being of cancer survivors. So patient-centric approaches in research, medical education, cancer management, and care delivery are critical to an evolving paradigm in cancer care. It involves navigating the healthcare system through patients' eyes, and it represents a flexible, multifaceted approach which can be customized for the best patient care. A health system that understands and monitors the needs, goals, value, and preferences of its patients and embraces shared decision-making and co-creation of care would be more resilient to sudden disruptions of routine care pathways. During the COVID-19 pandemic, the issue of foregone and disrupted care for non-COVID patient groups have caused a major burden on patients, and patient organizations have played an important role in supporting information to patients and self-management. For cancer patients to get the treatment that they require and deserve, a multidisciplinary team is needed to provide a patient-centered approach that addresses all aspects of the cancer journey, with emphasis on survivorship issues, including psychological support and improved quality of life, delivered within a framework where patients' rights and views are respected. Notably, multidisciplinary professional patient-centered institutions are best positioned to support research, provide training, capacity building, and provide the best care for patients, among others. So these multidisciplinary teams combine knowledge and ensure that the best treatment options are discussed with the patient and that the shared decision-making takes place. All treatment options should be considered and can be advocated by the relevant specialists. All relevant doctors, nurses, and other cancer care professionals should be informed and kept up to date through all stages of the patient's journey. Patients should receive information consistent with their wishes about their cancer, their diagnosis, and their treatment options. This will ensure a well-informed choice is made about their individual treatment and care. Next slide. Cancer affects a vast population of patients, survivors, relatives, and carers. The growing prevalence, uncertain life-threatening prognosis, and the high symptom burden make public policies relevant in cancer research to ensure that the rapid development of medical and oncological opportunities for diagnostics, treatment, and care is aligned with the needs and priorities of the growing population of people affected by cancer. This is why public policies should be developed and implemented to safeguard cancer survivors, working lives, their employability, skills, and capacity to work, as well as their motivation to work. Psychological support and palliative care are also necessary, as I already mentioned before. During recent years, personalized medicine has gained importance in cancer prevention, diagnosis, prognosis, and therapy. We know that today, each year, over 3 million people are diagnosed with cancer in Europe. So personalized medicine, while it used to be science fiction a few years ago, it is now steadily introduced into the daily clinical practice of healthcare professionals, including various individualized, molecularly targeted therapies with increased efficacy and reduced toxicity. So personalized medicine has an important role in early identification of cancer predisposition genes, as a screening procedure may help high-risk populations to make important decisions on individual risk modification behaviors. Cancer treatment can also be benefited as there are molecularly distinct subtypes of various common cancers, with different therapeutic approaches required for each subtypes. So the proven efficacy of several targeted approaches shows that a new era in the field of oncology is raising and requires decisions based on each person's individual profile and characteristics, with the ultimate goal to improve patient prognosis and quality of life. We need the governments to ensure the means to identify people who may benefit from more effective targeted cancer treatment and avoid treatment-related toxicity where possible, all while helping to ensure the sustainability of our healthcare systems. One such way to address this is with the molecular tumor testing or biomarker testing and personalized medicine, which is a targeted approach to the prevention, diagnosis, and the treatment of cancer. Awareness about molecular and genetic tumor profiling remains low. Only 23% of European doctors feel that their patients are always fully informed about molecular or biomarker testing, and the awareness is not homogeneous across Europe. This is why in 2018, we have launched the Personalized Medicine Awareness Month, which is in November, in which we condensate our activities around personalized medicine with a pan-European social media campaign, events, publications, and meetings. And our social media campaign toolkit is available on our website in several languages. The use of cancer molecular testing in Europe also varies by country and region, because in many countries, diagnostic tests are not integrated into clinical practice and are not reimbursed or available to all people with cancer. This needs to change as it further creates inequalities in Europe. So this is why we have launched a project with the IQN PATH and the EFPIA. And we have launched a research initiative to improve cancer care through broader access to quality biomarker testing. The goals of this initiative were to identify barriers to biomarker testing in the 27 new countries in the UK, and to develop policy recommendations in order to ensure that all eligible cancer patients have access to ideal testing paradigm. And the immediate action is paramount. Medicine development in oncology is rapidly evolving, facilitated by a greatly improved understanding of cancer as a genetic disease. It is therefore a matter of urgency to provide the biomarker testing infrastructures and the required processes in order to deliver the benefits of these therapeutic advances to patients and to ensure that the pace of innovation can be sustained. Next slide, please. Next. So this slide shows the reality across Europe of accessibility of biomarker testing, which is far from homogeneous. While biomarker testing is easily accessible in Central and Nordic European countries, it is still very difficult to access biomarker testing in Eastern Europe, where major structural changes are needed. Next slide. Personalized medicine is at the heart of Europe's Beating Cancer Plan, for which we are happy of. So the plan clearly recognizes the value of personalized medicine, a theme which cuts across many of the new initiatives it proposes to introduce, such as cancer diagnostics and treatment for all, which aims to support a greater sharing of tumor profile data with the aim of optimizing cancer diagnosis and treatment and reducing inequalities in access to personalized medicine. Then partnership on personalized medicine, new collaborative projects in high performance computing and artificial intelligence, a cancer inequality registry, which will identify disparities and inequalities in cancer care between member states and regions. And this could include exploring inequalities in access to personalized medicine. So this is why ECPC, we will continue to advocate for the integration of personalized medicine, secure fair reimbursement policies and accessibility to all European citizens who need it. And so we will start working soon with the EFPIA on establishing a task force to enhance personalized medicine through the implementation of the Europe's Beating Cancer Plan. So I'm moving towards the end of my presentation. So let me highlight ECPC support to an EU HTA regulation that is based on a patient-centric approach and that is aimed at reducing the burdensome administrative process of clinical assessments, supporting a collaboration between the member states and enabling the national health authorities to make timely and evidence-based decisions about pricing and the reimbursement of innovative health technologies. So in closer collaboration with patients and their advocates, health professionals, and public health organizations, we advocate for a strengthened HTA coordination at the EU level to avoid unnecessary duplications of efforts and promote more evidence-based health policies. The current HTA process is too fragmented and tends to create inequalities across Europe. And for us, cancer patient organization, it is inconceivable that one treatment is available on day one in one country, for instance, Germany, but then it takes up to 12 years to be available in another country, that could be Romania, for instance. So we advocate at the national and international level for HTA models that include and promote a systematic contribution delivered directly by patients. In fact, we can offer a unique perspective on the impact of our own condition and possible treatments on our everyday lives. So patient involvement in HTA allows the value of health interventions to be defined based on what really matters to patients. So patient preferences are thus fundamental to understand. For example, patient needs, the relative effectiveness of a treatment, the impact of treatment on the overall survival, patient issues like the relevance of clinical outcomes, the convenience of the treatment location. Patient's autonomy is also an important factor, or the economic evaluations. So maybe next slide. So in order to empower cancer patients to be part of the HTA process, at ECPC, we have developed a number of tools, including an e-learning module to motivate cancer patients to be part of the HTA process, which is available on our website in several languages. And based on the interest of our members, we can translate this e-learning module in many more languages. We have also developed a toolkit, which is a sort of step-by-step guide on what patients need to do and where they need to go in order to be involved in the HTA process. And this toolkit is now available for our members in Spain and Portugal, and it is very country-specific as it is a very practical guide. We have So we are now planning to implement the toolkit in other countries. We have done a lot, but a lot more needs to be done to make sure that cancer patients are systematically involved in the HTA process. So this topic is still very high on our agenda. Next slide. So to sum up, I would like to mention some of the main conclusions. As a TCPC, we believe that the increased focus on patients' preferences stands within the common will to strengthen the patient-centric decision-making process throughout the life cycle of medicinal products, including medical devices. Besides this, there is also a need to promote an interdisciplinary patient-centered approach, as well as the need of multidisciplinary teams to support the patient and provide the best treatment and care available. Here, public policies play a key role on safeguarding the patient's rights. To finish with, on the one hand, I would like to briefly mention personalized medicine, as it requires adequate resources, multidisciplinary expertise, access to data, sets analysis tools, and coordinated projects. On the other hand, HTA regulation that is based on a patient-centric approach. So I've reached the end of my presentation, and I will be looking forward to continue the debate on such a relevant topic for cancer patients. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Cardona. It was amazing. We really saw a lot of projects, initiatives, and tools that European Cancer Patient Coalition is involved in and initiates. In order to really help the patient and put them in the heart of the care and healthcare at all. And we have a question from the audience. Are cancer patients of today becoming more active and empowered? Do you have a vision on this?
Yeah.
And, yes.
Yes, definitely. I mean, we are working a lot on in order to empower cancer patients, and I see. I mean, even if we look at the evolution of cancer patient organizations and also the number of new cancer patient organizations that have been created in the last 10 years, that is a very good sign of how cancer patients are increasing their own awareness and their capacity to advocate for themselves. And so, yes, I mean, there has been a great improvement, although still a lot needs to be done. I mean, we have not achieved our goal yet.
And one more question, how do you choose patient representatives? What criteria do you look for? Is there any procedure or plan that you follow in order to choose this voice of cancer patients?
No, the patient representatives are that we work with are our members. So we normally check their availability, and then of course they have to be informed, trained, in order to express their own will. I mean, in order for patients to be part of this formal processes like the HTA process or patient preferences, they needed to be trained. I mean, it's not something that it's embedded in patients. Patients need to be trained, educated, and they need to become almost professionals in bringing up their own voice.
Thank you very much. Yes, a lot has been done, and I'm happy that you have plans for even bigger and more effective things to be there for cancer patients. Well, thank you for your time and thank you for the amazing keynote section of the agenda today. Now, half an hour break. We will have half an hour break and then we will continue with the Inspire to Live session focused on patient advocacy in oncology.